Saturnalia by Paul Fleischman, narrated by Charlie Thurston. Chapter 1. The weather vanes of Boston were pointed north, the frigates, the angels, the cocks, the cows, and so below was Mr. Baggot. Marching down a dim alleyway, he raised his eyes from the shin-deep snow and gazed with envy at a rooftop rooster. The wooden bird was perched high enough to be sunning itself in the first light of day, while he himself, mused Mr. Baggot, trudged along in perpetual darkness, walking the lightless lanes of sin, rooting out evil and blasphemy. Such was the life of a tithing man. It was December of 1681, and Tombstone cracking cold. Having bested 50 previous winters, Mr. Baggot was undeterred by the freezing gust of wind scouring his face, and strode powerfully ahead without pause, parting the gale with his hatchet nose. In one hand, he carried a well-worn copy of Spiritual Stepping Stones for the Young. In the other, he carried the symbol of his office, a walnut staff knobbed at one end and bearing a fox's tail at the other. In fulfilling his duties at Sunday's church service, he'd banged the staff's knob on the doltish heads of a variety of squirming, whispering, laughing, face-making, Satan-claimed children, while waking no less than 4 dozing adults with a tickle of the foxtail. Following this, he'd used it to trip a pair of boys running from the meeting house, had reported 2 men for swearing, and 1 for shamelessly splitting wood on the Sabbath, and yesterday, to his great disgust, had descended into the hellish waterfront taverns in search of disorderly patrons. How far this foul metropolis was from the paradise it had promised, a thought punctuated by the emptying from above of a chamber pot directly in his path. He turned onto King Street and nearly collided with a scissors grinder pushing his wheel. Tinkers, broom makers, fishwives, and wood sellers all sent their cries toward the roof of heaven. Horses, carts, and rumbling wagons shook the devil from bed below. Mr. Baggot tramped on, his cloak flapping in the breeze so that he seemed to be constantly changing shape, as if made of black quicksilver. In the distance, he glimpsed a pair of ships, sails full, leaving Boston Harbor. Closer at hand, he spotted a shop sign in the shape of a book and girded himself. Like the town's other tithing men, he had spiritual charge of 10 families, noting with care their attendance at services and testing their children's knowledge of scripture. Among the homes on his circuit, none distressed him like that of Charles Curry, printer, a man of great knowledge who seemed to prefer the companionship of his books on Sundays to that of his neighbors in church. And among the young under Mr. Curry's roof, none irked him like William, the printer's apprentice. Not because the boy failed to study, like most, but because he knew far too much. Mr. Baggot entered the printer's front room, causing the shop's bell to tinkle softly. Waiting for his presence to be noted, he sniffed breakfast, heard talking farther within, glanced about at the books, papers, pins, and other sundries for sale, coughed conspicuously, took off his cloak, listened to an outburst of general merriment, and finally pounded his staff on the floor. "Ah, good Mr. Baggot." Mr. Curry's round, reddish face appeared around a doorway. "You find us at breakfast. Will you take some bread and milk?"
"Bread and milk leave me hungry," Mr. Baggot replied sternly. "Feeding the soul is my object. Your children's ravenous ones this morning."
Mr. Curry smiled faintly.
"Allow me a moment to instruct their souls to fetch bowl and spoon."
Turtle-like, he drew in his head, while Mr. Baggot wondered whether he'd been mocked. He felt his anger smoke, then ignite, ransacked his brains for some revenge on the man, and found himself staring at a calendar for December on the wall. His eyes
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.